First of all, welcome to this class, Taxation of Trans-Pacific Transactions. It's a very fancy name, perhaps, but considering that, at least from what I've seen so far of the information that you've given me on yourselves, this course will be taught as what I'll call an introduction to international taxation with a focus on Asia Pacific, but different from other international courses in the program, it will not be taught from the U.S. perspective. The idea in terms of what I have hopes that you will carry away from this course is number one, I would say, an appreciation of taxation concepts that are pretty similar pretty much anywhere you are in the world. Pretty much similar. And some practical ability to take the situation of a company that you might work for or a client that you're responsible for, to understand their situation, be able to ask questions, understand how to then identify issues, and once you've figured out what the issues are, hopefully find some solutions for your client or for the company that you're working for. So this is the overall goal, both some knowledge and some practical ability to actually deal in the real world. Now, to try to get through in not too long some what I sort of think of as administrative things, I'd like to have some introductions in terms of who I am, who you are, a little bit about why you're here. That will help me certainly, and I hope will also help you. To start things off in terms of who am I and what am I doing here, I had the very good fortune to work in public accounting for, yes, roughly 32 years. And I have spent the majority of that 32 years in various countries around the world, living and working, practicing the taxation systems of those countries. The last time I practiced any U.S. tax was when I lived in Houston in 1986. So I am very dangerous where U.S. matters concern. But what I do retain is the concepts. And the concepts, a lot of them that we have in the U.S. system, are exactly what you find in China, in Japan, in India, various places. When I lived in Singapore, I used to read Indian tax cases because they were precedent for issues in Singapore or Malaysia. So this is, there is a tremendous amount of uniformity of concept around the world. And by having been in working in detail within the taxation systems of, I guess, six or seven countries over the years, I've seen what those similarities are and how they're real, and how you, if you become adept in one country system and understand how things work in one country, you actually know a lot more than you think you do about other countries. You're not going to know what their specific rules are, but you'll know what will be issues in other countries because there are issues here. Okay, let's see, in terms of a few more things about myself, let's see. Over the years, I've worked in originally New York for 7 years, then Hong Kong for a couple of years, Singapore for 3 years, Houston for 4.5 years. I had to look at a map to see where Houston was when I found out I was going there. That was rough. Then to Japan for 6 years, then to Russia for 5 years, then back to Japan for 3 more years, then to Turkey for a little over a year, and then I retired in 2001. During the New York period, I was with Touche Ross, which is one of the predecessor firms for Deloitte and Touche. And during the years overseas and in Houston, I was with Arthur Anderson. And I retired shortly before the Enron debacle started to unfold. I retired in 2001. I came out of retirement in 2006. I had had one regret from a career standpoint, and that was that in 97, when I left Russia, I had the opportunity to take over the tax and legal group within the Beijing office of Arthur Anderson. And I passed it up for a different job to go back to Japan, And I had this one regret that I had never worked in China. So from 2006 to 2008, I was in Shanghai working with the Deloitte and Touche firm as a senior advisor with no job description. So it was actually quite nice. Very much enjoyed that. So I'm now retired again, except for teaching here. And I've been teaching this course, except for the 2 years in China, since the 2003-2004 academic year. Do all of you have the this book or booklet? Okay, you'll find in there, if you haven't noticed, a listing of required recommended readings. You'll see that the absolutely required readings for this course are actually not that much. This paper that I've written over the years, which is the bulk of the book, a few other items, but there are a lot of other things out there that are useful, and the goal actually is not to read a lot and try to memorize, but to the extent that you have time, scan things to see what's there. Because in the real world, you don't upfront memorize things for what the issues of clients are. You have to react to clients. You have to learn what you need to know about their situation, and then, well, gee, where do I go to look to deal with this? So your knowledge of sources, your knowledge of what's available, is a lot more important than your reading a lot of stuff in detail. So do look through that listing, which is frankly relatively long, of recommended things, and get a feel for what's out there. If you have a real interest in this area, I certainly recommend these books. In some prior years, we have used this as a text, a required text. We're not now on the basis that the cost of them would perhaps bankrupt you. And unless you really want to get into this area, I'd say, you know, use your own motivation to buy them. There are several sets that are in the library. This is a series of books. There's going to be a third one eventually in another year or two, set of three. And they're written by a former partner of mine in Arthur Anderson. And he covers, in a lot of, I think, very effective detail, things that we're interested in this course. So I would suggest at least paging through them downstairs in the library and seeing what's there. If it's something you want, by all means, order. Okay, hands-on experience through case studies. I'm a firm believer that you learn by doing. And as a result, a reasonable amount of effort will be made that you'll have to make will be on a case study which has four parts to it. The first part, you're going to get a very short description of the background of this case study. Now, what is the most important part? You're going to hear me repeat this over and over again. So please, if you don't remember it the first time, you're going to remember it the second, third, fourth, or fifth time. The most important part of this kind of work is understanding what your client is doing. What is he doing? With whom is he doing? Who is he employing? Where are these people? Is he buying something? Where is he buying it from? Where is he selling it to? Where are the customers? What are the terms of the contracts? On and on and on and on. And the questions are really only limited by your imagination. And as you gain more and more experience, your recognition of what is relevant and what is not. So the first part of this case study will be, what do you need to ask the client? What do you need to ask the client? So you're going to give me your questions. And I'll pretend that I'm the client, and I will respond to you. You want to know that, where's ABC Incorporated? What's its capital structure? How many employees does it have? How many subsidiaries? Where are they? Whatever you ask, I'll respond. And I will give you, as a result, in writing, responses to your questions. Now, based on that, when we get to the third and fourth part of this case study, the first one will be that you have to analyze and come up with some sort of suggestion regarding a structure for this company, this group, to sell into two countries of your choice. And the reason why we pick two countries is because you may come up with totally different answers for each country because the particular rules or characteristics of each country is very different. So to demonstrate how things can vary and how every time you are looking at something, you really have to start with a blank sheet of paper and say, well, what's the situation? Where do I draw a box as to where this company will be? Or how many companies I need? Or what form they are? Here in the United States, we have corporations, on a state-by-state basis, of course, corporations, we have LLCs, we have partnerships, we have trusts. Well, you generally have similar things in other countries, but which one do you choose for those other countries? Where do you have a choice to use something or not? So coming up with some suggestions and preparing a report to present this. The fourth part of this case study will be to do the same thing with the two countries, but with the manufacturing facility in the country as opposed to just selling into the country. And again, the idea of this is that it will force you to look into, except where there might be an exception who is literate in another language, you will look to whatever English language sources there are for information on that country system. So you can decide, okay, what are the available entities? Do I want to use one of them? Why would I choose this, or why would I do something else? And how do I capitalize this thing? Do I bring machinery and equipment in, so to speak, or do I buy locally, or do I lease it? What do I do? So going through some of these things are what we're going to try to do so that you get a feel for resources and how to use them. The second part of the case study, which I didn't mention, is just is a first simple thing to get you into English language material in other countries by asking about what are the incentives that your chosen countries happen to be. And it, again, in terms of your particular interests, the goal is to have you interested in it, so choose the countries that you are interested in. If you're specifically interested in Vietnam because you don't have any Vietnamese language skills, then fine. And although this is called taxation of trans-Pacific transactions, if your real love is France, then fine, choose France. So I don't have any problem with choosing what interests you. Okay, so just to say a few more words about the course goals to amplify what I said before. The from my experience, the thing which makes you valuable is not specific knowledge of facts, knowledge of rules. I'm not saying they don't help. Of course they do. As a professional, you need to have some minimum level of technical knowledge, of course, and through experience that rises over time, of course. But what really makes you valuable is actually a methodology that allows you to help a client no matter what his question is. This is a little off the topic, but I can remember sitting in New York many, many years ago, and a client called and said, "What do you know about tire leasing?" Tire leasing. Well, I could have responded absolutely nothing and hung up the phone. But my response was, "Well, gee, what do you want to know?" And of course, that led into a series of questions to understand why they were interested in it. And after getting enough background, I knew, of course, absolutely nothing about tire leasing. I'd never heard of the concept previously. But I eventually talked to people in the tire industry, got copies of tire leasing contracts, understood what it was, eventually got back to the client with something that was able to help them. So it's a methodology more than it is a specific knowledge. Somebody says to you, "Well, gee, I'm going to have a contract with somebody in Nepal." Well, none of us have any knowledge. Well, maybe one of us does, but very few of us have any knowledge of what's going on in Nepal. But we can start asking questions, so that once we have enough background, we can decide how to approach it. Now, if it really is about Nepal, well, probably we need to contact and talk with a local professional there. But we, even though we may have no specific knowledge about Nepal, can be part of the process of satisfying the client's needs. So it's methodology more than it is specific knowledge. Now, obviously, through experience, through this course, certainly, and through experience, you'll gain knowledge, a broader knowledge of the concepts and skills in understanding what is out there in terms of international tax principles and, of course, how to use them. But again, it's a methodology of using them. It's not, gee, I know a technique for doing this. That's not the goal. And again, as I mentioned before, what research facilities are out there that are readily accessible to you? That's important. Where do you go? Now, again, select the countries you have a personal interest in, and you're going to learn a bit more about them because of being forced to through the case study approach. And the last point, I think, here, maybe there's another one, but this point, I think, is also important, and that is that you have to develop a sensitivity to the fact that sometimes things really work out perfectly. There's the system in one country jives perfectly with the system in another country. We'll probably talk about it in more detail at a later time, but has anybody ever heard of leverage leasing? Where, for example, an airplane or a ship is purchased by a lessor that then leases it to a user, an aircraft or a ship, to a user in another country. And the lessor is taking maybe accelerated depreciation on the asset in his country of residence. The lessee in its country is treating the transaction as for tax purposes in that country as if they own the asset and they take accelerated depreciation in that country. So things work perfectly. Both tax authorities are happy because the tax rules in the different countries are different. Same concepts, overall concepts apply, but you get a different answer in each country. And as a result, you get a wonderful answer that spawned a huge cross-border leasing industry. This started maybe 30 or 40 years ago and just grew and grew and grew. You'll sometimes hear references to a double-dip lease or even a triple-dip lease that you're taking depreciation, interest deductions, what have you, in more than one country. Now, just as there are situations that work perfectly together, there are plenty where we use the term whipsaw. Gee, you're paying tax over here, but you're not getting a foreign tax credit over here. And as a result, you're getting whipsawed. You're getting taxed twice on the same income. Terrible thing, double taxation. Yeah, well, it happens. So a sensitivity to the opportunities, a sensitivity to the horror stories is an important part of where you're coming from and what you need to have to be a good practitioner. Now, I think you'll see that pretty much everything we've talked about so far is true whether you're talking about an international cross-border situation or domestically. So I think these things will be helpful to your careers no matter what you do. Okay, so now let's talk for just a moment about what is international taxation. Now, why don't you read through this thing? Okay, that definition was taken from this book here. It certainly sounds nice, but I think as a practical matter, it's sort of meaningless from the perspective of, well, how do I visualize this? What does it mean? So as a result, what we'll do next is to illustrate what international taxation is by going through a case study. We will give a business situation. We will ask what happens if there is no tax planning done. What's the result? We'll see what happens. And then we can talk also about, well, what are some things that we could do which would give some different results, hopefully better results. So I think in my mind this is the best way of illustrating what is it that we're doing, what is this subject that we're trying to focus on. Now, read through this here. Okay, now, does anybody know what a petrochemical facility is? What does it look like?
Is it oil processing?
Yeah.
I just picture Louisiana oil, big tanks.
Yeah, yes, I'm hoping a hurricane doesn't come in to tear it apart. So, that's what it looks like. Let's just think about what additional information do you want to know in addition to what's here? Do you have any particular questions you'd like to ask? By asking what is a petrochemical facility, it's real. You have to understand what your client's product is. I did a lot of work when I lived in Houston, worked in Houston for the offshore oil industry. Well, gee, what's directional drilling? What's an intelligent pig? I mean, there's all sorts of terms and all sorts of things applicable to your client in his industry. What's a jack-up rig? What's a semi-submersible? Well, it's not that it's important for you to know specifically about the industry just for the sake of knowing the industry. There's an issue of you understanding what's significant about the industry because of your area of expertise. Okay, you're trying to give legal and tax advice as to this situation. So let's just, as an example, look at this and say, gee, does this look simple? Or does this look like maybe a high-tech thing? Yes, Jasmine?
Well, the one question could be that if the construction is going to be carried out in a country, in a different country, do you have all the various components available within that country?
Excellent.
Or do you have to import these? Is there a restriction in the country whether you can import these products from outside countries? There might be some custom duties, some taxes that you might have to pay on those if it is first legally allowed to do it.
Yeah, this is absolutely perfect in terms of the types of things that you have to be thinking about and asking. I mean, if you look, we have construction projects, you know, in and around Seattle, maybe not as many now as there were a few years ago, but occasionally there are construction projects where a big building is going up. Think about what goes into that. Think about the fact that there's all this material, building materials, equipment, what have you, that comes from various places, domestically or maybe internationally. Think about how somebody had to take the time. Think about the fact that somebody had to take the time to identify the specific materials that were needed. Somebody had to figure out what the alternative sources were, negotiate with all of these suppliers, potential suppliers, and then after signing contracts for the purchase of, you know, this thousands and thousands of materials that come into the project site, to arrange the timing so that they get delivered at the right time. Now, this is not an easy thing to do. It takes a lot of time and effort. Well, that's something of value. That's something that really is happening. And as you're saying, well, gee, where is this happening? If we go back to here, it doesn't tell you that yet. It just says that the facility is going to be built on land in country B. But we don't know whether all of the parts and the ordering of them, we don't know where that's going to happen. We know they're physically going to be put together in country B because somebody's got to weld them together or tighten bolts or what have you. But we really have to think not about tax rules. We have to think about what is happening. We have to understand physically what is happening. Who is doing what? Where is he doing it? How is he doing it? With whom? All of these questions. You look like you wanted to raise your hand.
How about the tax implications of staffing? So who's going to build it? Is the company that's building it, are they going to send staff over and so forth?
Yeah. Where are the people going to come from? Are they locals that are going to be hired for this job? Are there going to be specialists, supervisors brought over? So all of these sorts of things. Now, one other thing I'd like to point out from this. Again, does this look simple or does this look complex?
Complex.
You think you could make it with a, I'm not sure what they call them today. We used to call them erector sets when I was a kid. Maybe Lego? Is that?
I'm just a leather bit. Yes.
Yeah, I mean, do you just get a bunch of pipes and put it together? Or is there technology there? Yeah, there's some technology in this thing. So if you understand your clients, whether it's this thing or whether it's something else, if you understand your client's business, you're looking to understand what technology is involved. So that's an important aspect of this. Okay, so I said that what we want to do is to figure out what will happen if there is no tax planning. So let's move into that. The contract, the revenue was $200 million, and as described, the company's P&L for this, their internal profit and loss statement for this project, includes all these various expenses and a net income at the bottom of $48 million. let's pretend that, let's see, who's a good person? Andrew, you look like, you have sort of a Clark Kent look about you. So let's pretend that you are the country B local tax authority. Now, let's say that the work site is just across from the building where you have your office, and in fact, you have an office with a window. You're that high up within the organization, within the tax authority. You look out and you see this field with 400 people, you know, 400 workers running around on it doing things. And you're scratching your head and you're saying, gee, maybe there's somebody or something to tax. So your heart rate goes up, you know, you're all excited. And you walk out onto the field and you say, hey, who's in charge? So I say, I am. So what do you ask me?
What are you doing first?
Okay, well, it's fine. I'm the team here is building this this petrochemical facility for company Y.
Okay. Where are you from? I guess would be the next question.
Ah, where am I from? Oh, I'm part of company X, and company. Company X is from country A, and we're responsible to build this thing.
Who are you building it for?
We're building it for Y, which is a major petrochemical company, an oil company, major oil company in country Y.
I don't care about whether you have the proper permits. I'm just taxing the building.
Okay, that's fair. Now, it can, of course, there can be situations where somebody does think broader, but the reality is that usually somebody asks questions within his frame of reference. And, yes, assumes that there have been other permits granted for them to be there. But that is a legitimate question. Do you have permits? Can I see them? But anyway, go ahead. What else would you ask for?
Who are your workers? Where are they from? Are they B workers? Or are they A workers?
Okay, well, of the 400 workers, let's say 350 of them are locals that we hired, and the other 50 are people we brought in from other places around the world where we have operations, because we have 10,000 employees.
What about your materials? Are they B materials or are they elsewhere?
No, some are from here, some are from elsewhere. Is there anything that you might want to ask for that would be on a piece of paper? What did I hear you say?
For a contract?
Ah, the contract, yes, excellent, excellent. Now, generally, the contract is going to be one of the first things that is going to be requested. So, yes, we have a contract between X and Y, and you're going to want a copy of that. Now, let's assume that you get a copy of the contract, and it says in relatively simple terms, still may run to 150 pages, but in relatively simple terms, that X will build, design and build on a turnkey basis this facility at the job site. Y will pay for it, $200 million, and that's the basic gist of the contract. Obviously, in the other 149 pages, there will be plenty of description as to exactly what is going to be built and what the feedstock will be and what the output is intended to be and what will be a default and what will not be and so on and so forth. But the basic thing is design and build of this facility in exchange for $200 million. Now, you are the local tax authority. Seeing this, how do you want to tax these folks? How do you want to tax X?
I think it's going to depend on the laws or whatever our tax structure is.
Yeah, it's going to depend on your tax rules. Yeah, definitely. But let's look at what you would probably do. In the right-hand column, we have your tax computation that you have just made for this company. And notice that it looks pretty much like the project P&L. You see that the work site is in the country. Obviously, everything comes together within country B. You see nothing that suggests anything else, so you say, well, all $200 million of that is the revenue, which is taxable in country B. Now, as we've talked about, some of the raw materials are coming from elsewhere, and some of the workers are coming from somewhere else, and as we'll see later on, some of the design work is done somewhere else, not in country B. But as far as you're concerned, you see only the $200 million. There is absolutely no basis for you to divide up that $200 million and accept that some portion of it is not part of the income for country B. Because no planning has been done, there's no basis to come up with a nice, easy calculation which says so much income is in country B and so much income is elsewhere. So you say the whole thing is taxable, and this is common. I've certainly seen this many times before. Now, just to show that, of course, country B's tax laws can be different from company's project profit and loss account, we have a few items where there are differences. So, for example, no allocated interest cost over here. A lower amount of allowed central management and other support costs. We can talk later on as to, you know, what is that, but anyway, less of it. So we come up with a higher number, slightly, not that much, but a little higher. Multiply times 33%, and we get a country B tax of 16.5. Now, does this seem like a fair approach? Do you think he is being greedy? No, he's not being greedy. He's doing his job with what he has. And he's doing a reasonable job. So it does not appear that X in its tax calculation here is being treated unfairly. It has a contract, $200 million, do all this work, make $48 million in its sense, and it's going to be taxed $16.5 million. So, it doesn't sound unfair. Now, let's go to the next piece in this puzzle. And now what we're doing is we're taking the company profit and loss and we're breaking it up between functions and activities that happen either within country B or somewhere else. And then after dividing up the revenue side, we appropriately allocate the expenses against the in-country B income or the outside of country B income. Now, notice I say outside country B rather than in country A because this is a big company. They have operations in many countries. The activities might be not only in country A, but in other countries outside country B as well. So we decide, let's see, notice we're doing two things. We're breaking up on a value basis the 200 million into different categories, the labor, the construction materials, the engineering, the architecture, the technology. We're breaking that up on a value basis solely for purposes of our analysis. We're not doing it because there's a legal basis for breaking it up. There is no legal basis for breaking it up. But for our analysis purposes, we're doing it. And we see that the construction work, of course, by definition, is going to be inside country B. There's people welding and tightening huge bolts and what have you and moving pipes here and there. So those workers are all physically inside country B. Construction materials and equipment, we're assuming that some percentage of each is inside country B, is sourced, that is, purchased locally, and some is imported from outside country B. We're looking at the engineering and design services, and we're saying that's pretty much all outside of the country. Now, sometimes there might be, in reality, a small site office that'll support that effort, but for simplicity, I'm saying here that it's all outside. Same with the architectural services. And notice technology, the last one. We're saying that this facility, which looks so complicated, has the technology related to it, has a value of 20 million. And again, that reflects the fact that company X has been in business for 75 years and has slowly developed some very, very cutting-edge technology over this many period of years. So that's part of its fund of assets. It might be zero on the balance sheet because the cost to develop all of that was expensed year by year by year. That's just part of salary costs, part of facilities costs. But the fact that you see a zero on the balance sheet for technology doesn't mean it does not exist and somebody will not pay for it. So that value of 20 million is real. Okay, we then allocate expenses appropriately against those items of income. And we come down to the bottom where we see that the 48 is divided between $34.5 million in country B, and about $13.5 million outside country B. Okay, the next one is now comparing the onshore country B project P&L to the country A foreign source taxable income computation. So does anybody remember, why do we care about foreign source taxable income? For the foreign tax credit. Okay, and the foreign tax credit is important because, of course, we will calculate a country A tax. We will have paid 16.5 of country B tax, and to the extent we can take a foreign tax credit, we can reduce our country A tax on a dollar-for-dollar basis so that we eliminate double taxation. Okay. So this foreign source taxable income computation is rather important. And when we say, why exactly is it important, we really need to get to that foreign source, to the foreign tax credit limitation formula, and just have a little sense for the moment as to how it works and what it means. So if we wanted to know what the foreign tax credit limitation is, any idea? Anybody remember what that formula is?
Foreign source taxable income over
worldwide.
Worldwide tax.
Multiplied by.
Yeah. By the, if you're doing U.S., let's see, we always just say 35%. What are the applicable tax rates going to be?
Okay. Yeah. Well, the point is the tax. Before the actual tax, before credit. Now, this formula you will find in the foreign tax credit mechanisms of pretty much every country that has one. They're all pretty much the same. So, if you, to sort of get to what you were saying, you said, well, gee, 35%, you're assuming, of course, that the average rate in the U.S. for this large company will be 35%. But where does that come from? Well, the actual tax before foreign tax credit over worldwide taxable income, that's your effective tax rate, which you're saying in the U.S. is usually going to be around 35%. Okay, so we could certainly change this slightly and say the foreign source taxable income times the effective tax rate in the country. Okay, so if this is what did we see? We saw that for the project P&L that was the portion that is within country B, we saw that that comes out to about $34.5 million. So to the extent that the foreign source taxable income is around 34 and a half per, you know, million. Well, that would be wonderful. But when we actually do the computation, that's not what happens. We now have 17 down here. And if we have 17 times the average effective tax rate, as opposed to 34 and a half million times the average effective tax rate, we have a much lower number. And as you pointed out, it's the lower of the actual foreign tax or the limitation. So this is an absolutely terrible result. Absolutely terrible. So what's causing it? Now, one thing which is important to notice is that this column for the foreign tax credit limitation calculation is based on country A's tax laws. It is not affected at all. It's not affected at all by country B's tax laws. So you're going to apply the home country rules to calculate the foreign tax credit limitation. So to the extent there are differences between how country B is actually taxing and how country A calculates what, under its concept, country B should have taxed, if there's a difference, that could be a problem. So we look at this, and for various reasons, we have, let's see where the differences are. Okay, so the rental value, there's a couple of million difference. The technology, there's a major difference. And then there's some differences that are smaller down on the allocated interest cost and central management and other support. When we go to our last schedule, we now calculate the country A tax, and we come up, okay, with a net income of 44, and we apply the 30% rate, which is the country A rate, a little less than country B. We come up with a country A tax before foreign tax credit of 13.2. And then we calculate the foreign tax credit, and here's the formula. The tax before credit times foreign source taxable income of 17 over 44 worldwide taxable income. And that comes out to 5.1. So that becomes our foreign tax credit. So we actually have to pay country A $8,000,001. We, to see what our total tax obligation is, we of course have to add on the amount paid to country B. And that gives a total of $24,600, which gives us an effective tax rate of well over 50%. Now that's a terrible answer. It's a terrible answer. So But before we ask the question, which we'll start after the break, why did this happen? We said that, you know, you, our local tax authority, was not being unduly greedy. Yet we ended up with this absolutely terrible answer. So we're going to ask after the break, but why did this happen? What are the factors that contributed to this? We were looking at this, and this attempts to summarize what I was saying before, that country A wants $8 million, country B, and we all agreed country B was not being greedy, took 16 and a half. We get a total, we get a high effective tax rate. So what caused this? What happened? What economically happened with the way that the two countries' tax systems worked or did not work very successfully together? Now, maybe a good starting point would be to take a look back at this and see where the significant differences are between the two. If we look at the revenue, what's happening there? 137 versus the total of 200. And we know that country B's tax computation started out at 200. So there's a $63 million difference between them. Now, without getting into detail, is there something evident about that big difference? Where does that come from?
Well, they were, country B is taxing the revenue on work that was performed in country A.
Yeah, exactly. Country B, by starting off with 200 million, now country B is allowing, of course, all expenses. So, you know, they're not being unfair about it, so to speak, but the fact remains that whatever profit there is that relates to that $63 million difference, $63 million difference, that profit, country B is taxing, but country A is saying, country B should not have taxed that, and because under my rules they should not have taxed it, I'm not going to allow a foreign tax credit against the profit on that $63 million. The concept, we'll get into more detail in a future session, but the concept of the foreign tax credit mechanism, if you think about it, is to retain for the home country, its ability to fully tax income which is sourced in country A. The home country says, I have first right and the only right to tax the income which is earned within the home country. Fine, I'll give a benefit, a foreign tax credit benefit, if you earn income that's under my rules earned outside of the country and somebody else taxes you on. But I will tax, come hell or high water, I will tax whatever net income there is from activities within my borders. So that's one of the major differences. Okay, notice over here we have technology previously developed by X internally in country A, and there's zero on that line. And then current R&D expenses allocable to foreign source income, $4 million. When country B did its tax calculation, was there any deduction for for technology? We have down here technology previously developed by A, by X in country A. And that's zero both in the project P&L and in the country B tax calculation. Now, X, of course, has a big R&D department. They're continually doing research in their particular area on chemical processes and refining methods and so on. But those are about future technologies. Those direct expenses have absolutely nothing to do with this project, because this project is using technology that was developed over the past 75 years. So country B, as well as the project itself, is focusing on things that are directly related to the project. And this year, there are no expenses related to the technology that is being used in this project. So country B is taxing without any deduction for technology. But when we get to the foreign source taxable income computation and the actual tax, tax computation for country A, then country A says, well, you have to take some of your R&D expenses and allocate them over all categories of gross income. And as a result, that reduces by $4 million the foreign source taxable income, as well as, of course, the total net income. So that's another aspect here. We also saw that in the these are smaller, but we also saw where country B did not allow all of the deduction of interest and central administrative costs. So that's another area of difference. Now, we've seen that with no planning, we ended up with a terrible result. So now let's spend a few minutes thinking about, well, gee, what might we, what perhaps could we do to help the situation? So let's start out and say, well, gee, what's our goal? So we know that country A's rate is 30%, country B's rate is 33%. Let's say a non-greedy goal is to be somewhere in between those rates. And if we can achieve that, that sounds like a pretty fair result. So we'll talk about that. Now, maybe we should come back to this question at the bottom after we've talked a little about what might we do to alleviate the situation, and ask about that. So let's go back to our basic picture. Now, I've always found that the best way to think, the best way to see relationships is to draw pictures. And as a result, let's draw some things out. Now, let's go back to some of the questions that you had asked before. You said, for example, where are people doing things? Where are the raw materials coming from? So let's take the raw materials first. I think we said roughly that 25% of the raw materials were coming from outside of country B, and that some high percentage, maybe 75% of the equipment was coming from outside country B and would be imported into this. Now, any ideas as to how to identify and segregate from country B some amount of gross profit that relates to those imports? Now, we mentioned earlier that there's a lot of value in terms of this effort to identify what materials and equipment are needed and to find sources, negotiate, eventually conclude contracts, and then arrange for delivery at the right time. So there's obviously some people that are out there doing something. And let's say that for the term of this project, let's say that those people who are related to the these materials which are going to be purchased and imported, let's say that those people have combined salaries and facility costs of $2 million. Just pull a number out of the air. Say it's $2 million. And let's say that they are all physically back in country A to keep things simple. Any ideas what we should do? Okay, well let's assume that with respect to the materials that we have I'm pulling numbers out of the air as opposed to numbers that are consistent with this, but let's just assume that there's $25 million of raw materials and equipment that will be imported, that will be sourced outside of country B through the efforts of people sitting in country A and then delivered to the work site, imported, delivered to the work site, and then incorporated in the finished product.
So I would think that like that $25 million, I guess I think of it like as in a value-added tax concept, like that's your basis, and then the value of these materials on the job site when the job is done would be that appreciation from the $25 million to that would be a fair tax.
Okay, well, okay. That's you're going in the right direction. Let me put some more numbers on this so we're playing with something specific. Let's say that that's the value out of the $200 million. That's the value. The actual cost paid to the suppliers, let's say, is $15 million. And we have expenses, we said, of $2 million for the people and the facilities cost and so on. So we come down and we say we have a net income of $8 million that relates economically to the provision of raw materials, construction materials, and equipment that will go into the building. Right now, we have only X and we have Y. Y and X are unrelated. Now, one of the beauties of this business is that we can start with a blank sheet of paper. Now, here we can see through, so this isn't really blank, but we can start with a blank sheet of paper. And let's assume for a moment that instead of calling you an advisor, calling you after he shows up at the door and says, you know, give me my money, that the client X actually goes to you before they sign the contract. X goes to you at the time when they are in fact bidding for the job. So you can advise them on what contract terms and what structure would be best to use when they actually sign one or more contracts with Y. Blank sheet of paper. So let's start with a blank sheet of paper and see where that takes us. We know we have X, we know we have Y, we know we have our boundary between the two, and we know we have our work site. Now, when X and Y sign a contract, when X bids, makes a bid, does it have to put everything into one contract?
No.
No, okay, so what could it do?
Well, it can separate the onshore and offshore activities, so that, I guess that 8 million number that you had prior to that was all onshore, maybe not onshore, but not in country
B. That's right, yeah, offshore country B.
Yeah. That you could keep that separate. So then the contract with Y would only include things that would be going on in country B.
Okay, so let's take what you're bringing up. Let's say that X does a few things, and I'm shortcutting the process, but we're still going to get to the same place. Let's say that X finds out that for regulatory and other reasons, it would be useful to form a subsidiary, let's call it Z, for others of us, we'll call it Z. Anyway, it forms Z here, and let's say that Z enters into a contract with Y for the local construction work. X could form another subsidiary. Again, I'm bringing up different subsidiaries just for, let's say, for illustrative purposes, whether the functions stay inside X or are put in a different subsidiary. That would be part of your planning, but let's assume that we decide this is the best. So let's say we put into that company those people that we said are involved in the purchasing function. Those are the people who are going to figure out the sources of all these construction materials and equipment that's going to be purchased outside of country B and imported to the work site. Now, if Y is flexible, we of course would like Y to contract directly with W for all of those items, for the purchase of all those imported items. Why would we prefer it this way? The alternative, obviously, is instead of here, to sell to Z. why would we, all things considered, prefer a sale from W to Y instead of W to Z?
The W to Z might have, at least under U.S. tax laws, like it's, then it's related parties, which are going to trigger certain sections of the code that won't be triggered with unrelated parties contracting.
Yeah, most countries nowadays have intercompany transfer pricing rules. And to the extent that you can avoid having a related party transaction that's directly related party, you're better off. Now, you might also find, broadening the view a little bit, why, being a major oil company for that country, sometimes in other countries, a major player like that has the ability to bring in certain things with lower import duties, maybe no value-added tax on the importation, in contrast to Zed, that has no political power or other ability to do these things. So that's another factor. You look like you want to say something.
Do you think there would also be transaction costs involved if you sold it to Z first and then Z, I guess, sold to Y?
Transaction costs, in what sense?
I don't know. There's two steps involved instead of one. I think maybe there's more transaction costs, but maybe not. Z's taking care of the project and Y.
Oh, you mean if the item is going from W to Z and then to Y?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's no question there's two transfers, but will that cause any additional tax potentially, but let's say normally there's not significant extra amounts. If you're talking about real estate where there's transfer taxes, then selling from A to B and then from B to C, or sometimes securities where there's where there are again stamp duties or such, having an additional transaction can put reasonably high additional costs, and those costs are not income taxes, so they're normally not creditable against the home country tax. So yes, there can be transaction costs, but more in the nature of real estate or securities or something that's subject to, like I say, a stamp duty or some sort of transfer tax. Okay, now we said that W is going to buy from all these suppliers we said it's going to pay those suppliers 15, whether it sells to Z or directly to Y. We know its income, let's say, is going to be 25, because we've done some good supportable valuation of how much of that 200 is related to this. So we know that 25 is going to be the income. We said there were other expenses of the human beings of 2. So we have, by this mechanism, we have placed 8 within W. Now, when a foreign company sells an asset, a book, a pen, a computer, a desk, when W sells to Z or Y, is there any tax in country B? Does country B attempt to tax the gross profit on that transaction? What does the U.S. rules say? You've presumably looked at if I remember correctly, section 881 or 871 if you're a non-resident alien individual. What does the U.S. do? Does the U.S. say, I'm not going to tax that, or on what basis would they tax it?
Well, it's just personal property. It's like you were title passes in the U.S.
Okay, now you're talking about source of income. Let's assume, in fact, the title passes inside country B. Title passes inside the U.S. Let's assume it's U.S. source. What is required for effectively connected income under the U.S. rules?
U.S. trader business.
Ah, U.S. trader business. So, does W look like it has a trade or business? Or to use the more commonly used expression, which also is much higher in terms of threshold, is there a permanent establishment in country B of W? Does W have a place of business in country B? Does W have its own people at a fixed place of business in country B? And the answer is no. Now, you've looked some at the U.S. concept of trader business. It's a very, very low threshold. You don't have to be doing very much to have no U.S. trader, I mean, to have a U.S. trader business. You don't have to be doing very much. But most countries have a much higher threshold. But in this case, even under U.S. rules, if W is careful, if W follows the rules that its real people at its real office, wherever that is outside the U.S. or outside country B, do their thing from that place, even if title passes here, it will be untaxed as far as that gross profit of eight. So what have we done? We have separated out eight of gross profit, and we have, by isolating it in a company which, because of its factual circumstances, is not taxed in country B, we have reduced by $8 million the net income subject to tax in country B. Okay, so this is one aspect. Let's take the architectural services or the, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Would it ever be feasible to set up, like could you set up, like have Z instead do all that purchasing and maybe have Z be independent enough that it's not taxed in country A since the country Y or the country B tax rate was less?
Okay, that's a good
get
question.
Get the $8 million in the country B and not in country A?
Yeah, absolutely that might be appropriate planning. But what type of country will it be appropriate planning for? The U.S., which is what all of us are physically in right now, has a worldwide taxing system. Now, we'll talk more about this on a future session, but some countries have a territorial system. And yes, if the home country will never tax the earnings inside Zed, and especially if it turns out that, let's say, country B's tax rate is lower than the home country, you will very much desire to push more income in the one country and away from the home country. So, again, this is one of the things that's so much fun about this monkey business that we are working with, that yes, the goals can change 180 degrees depending on this kind of question. So very, very good question. Okay, so we've talked about, just briefly, we've talked about gross profit on importation of product. What about the engineering and design activities, again, which are happening back, let's say, within X? What about them? Again, we could either leave them inside X and have a contract between, let's say, X and Z, or between X and Y if Y is flexible enough. And we can, for example, if the expenses are, let's say, $5 million, and if the real value related to that design work is, let's say, $9 million, then we can have another $4 million, let's say, of gross profit, or of net income, so to speak, which is recognized and earned in X. And again, there are exceptions, but most countries do not tax service income, which is not sourced within their own country. And many countries do determine source for services based on where the services are performed. So again, if country B was the US, sounds like this would escape taxation as well. So that's a second one. Let's take one more. What about the technology? Now, the technology really is being used in country B. Technology is being used in country B. So we're not going to be able to eliminate taxation on the technology. Right now, without planning, what was the tax rate that was being applied to that economic technology income? Remember, we said the country B tax rate was 33%. Now, let's assume that the withholding tax on interest, dividends, and royalties that country B imposes, let's say, is 10%. Now, if we can arrange for, again, either Z or Y to pay either X or some other company that owns the rights to that technology a royalty for that, now we have reduced the tax on the net income related to that from that 33% down to a 10% withholding tax basis. Now, notice that the withholding tax is on gross income. The 33% is on net income. So this is only a benefit to the extent that we're creating income where there's not much in the way of economic expenses against it. But for this purpose, in this situation, this will be a major benefit. Let's pretend that we've done all this wonderful planning. We've now reduced that 16.5 country B tax, let's say, down to 6. Now, Andrew over here, he's our local tax authority. He held out his hand before and got $16.5 million. We've just done some things, and there's only six here. What's your reaction? Yeah, you saw that. It went like that. This table is too solid. Yeah. Some places you really make a lot of noise. Do you think that's really what's going to happen? Is he actually going to take off his shoe like Khrushchev did and pound it on the table because of this? You think that's what's really going to happen? Now you're shaking your head no. Is that because he's a nice, mild guy, or do you have some other reason?
Both.
Both. How well do you know him?
Well enough.
Okay, so ignoring the fact that you know him, what other reason might there be that he might not get so mad?
Well, for one, it doesn't affect his pocket personally. It's not like he's pocketing nothing.
Well, that's fair, but if he gets 16 and a half this year instead of six, maybe he'd get a promotion because he's such an effective guy. So I think we have to say there's some personal interest. But you're right. He's an honest guy. He's not putting a bribe in his pocket. I'll go along with that. Okay. I don't want to belabor the point, but if you have done your planning properly, he's as happy as a clam. He's absolutely overjoyed at getting $6 million. Why? Because he doesn't know that he could have gotten 16.5 in tax planning, whether it's domestic or international. You create the view that you want the tax authority to see. He doesn't see just X and Y and nothing else. You present to him, you know, here's Z, and Z is earning this much money and paying all this tax, and here's this 10% withholding tax on a big royalty. He's overjoyed. He is absolutely overjoyed. He might look around and make sure the transfer pricing is okay, and maybe he thinks that, well, it should be a little higher here or a little something else there. But he's talking normally not about the structure. He's talking about how the transfer pricing is, or whether a small item is deductible. He's taking the environment that we have created for him. He doesn't know that he could have gotten 16.5 if we did nothing. So part of this monkey business is to create. Now, whether this is the right chart for this client or not, well, it takes the effort to look through it. Should Zed be a separate company inside this inside country B? If so, what form of organization should it be? In addition, you have the choice of making Z a subsidiary in country A and operating inside country B through a branch. You have the opportunity to put Z in country C and then have a branch from country Z. You've got all of these choices. There's no right or there's no wrong. It's just what works best. And you can create that. You really start out with a blank sheet of paper when the client allows you to start out with a blank sheet of paper because you're at the point where they're making the bid. And in fact, you can add so much value to this that maybe X, when it does its bid, can't effectively ask for $190 million instead of $200 million and still get economically the same net income at the end after tax. And because they asked for $190, they have a better chance of getting the contract than the other competitors who are bidding. So you really can add value, but a lot of times it means educating your client to talk to you up front. So this is international tax planning. What happens if you don't do it, and a little bit of what it is to achieve something. Now, is it ethical? We've just taken and gone from 16.5 to 6. Are we doing, are, you know, by being in this class, is that unethical behavior? That's good. It's a little worried there. Okay, why? Aren't we cheating country B? We're reducing their tax by 10.5 million?
It's all within the law.
It's not only within the law. I'll step back a little bit and say, we'll talk eventually. I don't know that we'll get to it tonight, but next time we'll talk more about, ethics and penalties and this sort of area. But if you say it's within the law, you may, you know, obviously, let's say you're absolutely right, it's within the law. But the environment today doesn't allow us to stop there. Something may be within the law, but the risk today and today's environment with media, government, media especially, because they don't understand anything of what they report on in these areas, the consequences go far beyond, well, gee, we'll have to pay a little tax and some penalty if they catch us. There has to be consistency between the form you have created and the substance which is within that form. So it's not just running some sales through W and putting some gross profit up there. It's that W actually bears the expenses of real activity, real human beings who are doing something. That gives it legitimacy that it is an independent entity that should be treated as an independent entity, earning whatever income it earns. So our ability to structure a royalty instead of some other kind of transfer of technology, that's where we have a choice. Okay, once we make that choice and we put between the different entities the various legal rights and responsibilities that are represented by a license agreement, and the parties act like they take that agreement seriously, generally around the world, courts, tax authorities respect those things. It's where there's a divergence between the form and economically what's happening within that form that we, in a sense, get into more and more trouble. Yes, something may be within the law, but if we don't have the economics right, we still have a lot of exposure. More and more countries are, gravitating toward a substance over form doctrine, and the environment that really forces it on us. Now, interestingly, an item I just read regarding India a couple of days ago specifically goes the other way, where where India recognizes that form trumps everything on one particular issue regarding treaty shopping. So where it's that way, fine, use it, but understand it can change. Things change. And generally they're going in the direction of more and more substance. So yes, what we are doing is ethical, but we have to be doing it with this recognition that what we create has to have some substance within it. And how, as we talk through various things during this course, we'll try to put more meaning as to what is that substance? And what do courts and tax authorities recognize as constituting substance? Yes, sir.
Well, I kind of saw why it was ethical was kind of taking out the changing of the light, making it a licensing agreement, but the two other activities that were going on were happening in the initial transaction as well. It's just that in country B, he wasn't able to divide, divide it out. So it's not like we're doing anything different. It's just that it's easier. Now you can see it. It's in a contract and it's legally binding.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. But again, what this demonstrates, which again, I'll repeat myself over and over again, we really have a blank sheet of paper. You can create boxes wherever you want and see what works best. Now think about this. The tax authorities have to accept whatever we create as long as it has reality. Reality. I mean, all this is a fiction anyway. A legal entity is a fiction. If I create, whether it's an LLC or a corporation, I own 100% of it, but gee, I've got this legal fiction that that entity is a separate legal person. Laws, courts, tax authorities accept this. This is the environment we're in. Yet we as the taxpayers or advisors to the taxpayers, we have full freedom to create another company. It gives us a little advantage. Okay, so it's $1,000 of legal expenses and another $1,000 a year of maintenance costs. Well, if it's worth it, that's a small price. But we do that, and we have a box which is recognized. You've got to, for a country tax authority to disregard a legal entity, you've got to really do some things wrong. I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but it's pretty seldom. Okay, I'd like to talk a little bit more about methodology. And again, I believe that your ability to apply methodology, think about what you're doing, get involved with what you're doing, is a lot more important than specific knowledge. Again, over a career, your experience will slowly and slowly increase, and you'll have more knowledge. But the most important thing is really how do you approach things. So starting off with what I'll call step one, just absolutely critical to understand the background and facts. And it means you have to ask questions. And what might some of those questions be about? Okay, obviously, what's the business and its processes? What commercial goals and objectives does the company have? Legal structure, obviously. What tax attributes? And clients' understanding and acceptance of tax risk. Now again, this last one we'll talk more about later, but making sure that you really that's the right person within your client organization really understands the risks of the choices they make is very, very important. It's dangerous today as a professional to not be communicating that effectively to the right person within the organization. Last thing, see that you're interested in your client's business, or show that you're interested in your client's business. They will absolutely love you. Now, I don't know how many of you have had, let's say, any experience with clients at this point in your careers, but I think it's fair to say that there are a lot of lawyers out there who respond to clients showing them what we know. You know, somebody comes into the office and says, gee, I need to form a company. So you say, well, you know, there's a, you know, a corporation in Washington, there's an LLC, there's a partnership. You know, what kind do you want? I know all about them. Partnership has to have you know, one general partner, and you know, you can just go through facts forever. And most professionals do it that way. They don't say, gee, why are you here? You say you want a company. Why? What are you going to do? The focus has to be not on what I know, but on what you want. Why are you sitting here in front of me? Somebody calls up and says, what's the withholding tax rate for royalties from Singapore? Well, we look it up and we say, gee, it's, I don't know, 10%? Why are you asking? Who's going to pay you a royalty? Is this some new transaction you're getting into? Is the payer of the royalty related, unrelated? Do you have you put together a license agreement yet? If you have, could you send me a copy? There's a lot of things that you need to know. And if you just answer a question because you want to show what you know, you're not getting to what the real needs of the client are. Because the client doesn't actually know what his real needs are. So we have to be interested in their business. And if you show real interest, I mean, this is serious. They do absolutely love you. If you really want to understand what their business is, whether it's a petrochemical facility or directional drilling or whatever it happens to be. I mean, how often do they get to talk to somebody about what's important to them? They absolutely love it and will be better off for knowing their business and better off because you'll have a better relationship with your client by far. That also means less trouble collecting fees. Okay, just an example how things can change. This, I think, was from, I want to say 2008. And if we go back to, let's say, year 2003, 5 years earlier, in this chart, most of the companies interested in, most of the non-Chinese companies interested in doing business in China would have said they're there for the cheap labor. Now, 63% say that they want to be there because, hey, there's 1.3 billion people who are potential buyers of our product. Things can shift. So understanding goals, understanding how they might change, very important. The second point here, when you talk to somebody at a, who is not himself a lawyer, they generally think along product or service lines and not along legal entity lines. Gee, I work for General Motors. Gee, General Motors probably used to have 1,000 subsidiaries. People don't necessarily know which subsidiary they work for. They probably never noticed the name at the top of their payroll check. And even so, it might have been that there's a company which does, within the group, that does common payroll services. And that's the name they see at the top. They might not even know, technically, who their employer is. But this is of grave importance for us. We have to know who this employee works for, because if this employee is sitting here in an office in country B, that means that his employer has a place of business or something in country B. So we need to know these things. These are details. And we need to be able to ask the questions. And we need to be able to recognize that very often clients don't know. Maybe they're things that either we have to talk to the appropriate people directly within their organization, or this is something for him to get back to us on. In my mind, when I'm sitting down with a client, I try to use this mechanism. I sort of think through this mechanism to make sure I'm not missing something that I think might be material. So I sort of use these five categories. Now, there are some obvious questions with people. Where are they? What are they doing? What economic and work functions are they performing, and who's their employer? I mean, it's pretty easy to ask questions like that. And the idea is, at least for me, to have a mechanism that sort of reminds me of where I need to focus my attention. I present this this five-heading approach not as being the right one for you, but being one which is an example. You decide, you create your own to the extent that, yes, you find something that works better for you. Product and services. What is it? Where manufactured? Where performed? What is the service? What entities are involved? And if there's two or more entities, what is each one doing? Yeah, you have copies of these slides in the TWIN website, the Westlaw website. So do feel free to take down my golden words, but this is available. Intellectual property and tangible property. Now, intellectual property is extremely easy to miss unless you open your eyes and ask for it. Generally, especially operating people and financial people, they do not think about what they do not see. And an intangible, especially, you know, it's sort of ephemeral. It's you can't touch it. You don't know it's there unless you consciously think about it. So the obvious questions, first, identify it. What is there? And which entity owns it? And which entity uses it? A lot of times, I see situations where the home country company owns, in reality, a lot of technology. They form a new subsidiary in country B. And they never actually document any, they never actually document how the technology which is used within the subsidiary got there. Well, gee, they transferred human beings that happened to have some of that knowledge. Well, should there have been a license agreement? Or do they want to transfer ownership? What do they want to do? So anyway, this is a major area because technology can be a very, very high value thing. It's like the elephant you cannot see in some cases, which is a problem. If you draw a picture and follow the cash and financial flows, you'll identify where there needs to be some sort of documented relationship. There's a subsidiary. There's money in that subsidiary. Where did it come from? How did it get there? Well, maybe some came through issued capital. Maybe some came through intercompany loans. Maybe some came through just an open account that they're really not documenting very well. Well, we're pretty sloppy in the United States with respect to documenting a lot of things. Other countries get concerned about the need for proper documentation. So drawing a picture and identifying where there's movements and figuring out, well, gee, there should be a, you must have a license agreement because of this flow here. Please give me a copy of it. I need it for my, to understand all the background in this. And of course, legal documentation itself. The first point, it's critical that you read it and understand it. I don't know how many times I have been told by a client when I ask for a particular document, oh, you don't need to see that. All it says is, and he tells me. And at least 50% of the time when I actually, after pounding on the table and getting a copy of the document, at least 50% of the times what he has told me is wrong in some material respect. Clients do not understand what is in their own documents. They don't read it every day. They don't remember. They may have never read it because maybe it's 5 years old and they've been in their position for 3 years. They just don't know. They're not being malicious. They're not trying to mislead us. They just don't know. But they think they do. So it's absolutely critical that you read these things. Even when you're reading something and you're looking at boilerplate, you've got to look at it closely enough to make sure there's not something unexpected. Because you could find unexpected things that have major tax consequences in the strangest places. I mean, I could certainly give some examples. Okay, I think this is probably a good place to call it quits, unless you all want to continue on. See, I'm just waiting for that time when you say continue talking. I'll accept that you might have something else to do tonight. Okay, well, any other questions before we pack up? Okay, well, thank you very much. Have a good evening.